Hello everyone, welcome to the editorial of this problem. Let's read the question. Well, the question says, consider the generalized Fibonacci number G, which is dependent upon A, B, and C as follows. Okay, the initial two terms of this Fibonacci series are given to you. And the relation is here. Okay, what you have to do is, if you have to find Gn, then you'll be doing A times Gn minus 1 plus B times Gn minus 2 plus C. So this is a little variation of your regular Fibonacci. Which has some constant multiplied to it, all right? So these values of the constant, these constants are going to be given to you here in this function, all right? Now, what is your task? Obviously, you have to find the nth term, but you have to return the answer in the modulus with m. Now, what is this m? M is yet another number that you will be receiving as your parameter, okay? So let's see. This is the function which you have to complete, and you are getting a, b, c, and n. M here. All right. Then the very important thing that you have to notice in this problem is whatsoever approach you form, that should be of log n complexity. Okay. So it is not going to be a very regular Fibonacci of kind. Seeing these examples, we as an input for the first one, we have received 3, 3, 3, 3, and 5. Okay. The output here is 4. The formula is used by calculating this formula. We are receiving the output as 4, right? Same goes with this example. We will be going to see this in detail. Let's calculate it ourselves. Okay, here we have those same examples. Let's calculate it. For this question, the initial two values are always the same, 1 and 1, g1 and g2. Now we have to figure out what is g3. All right, so for this g3, we have to do a3 multiplied with gn minus 1. If this is 3, this is n minus 1. All right, and this is n minus 2. So for here, we have to multiply it n minus 1. For this, it is 1 plus 3. Again, multiplied with n minus 2, it is again 1. And then we have to multiply, we have to add c with it. All right, so we have this. The answer we will receive is 9. But is this the right answer? What we have to do is we have to modulo it with this value, the m that we are given. So when we put here, the answer we will receive is 4. Alright, so the next value of this series is going to be 4. And further on, this is how the series will be calculated, but the answer we have to return is only this nth value, right? Let's solve this question as well. So in this case, what is happening? Again, the two values are going to be 1 and 1. And we have to find the fourth value, right? For that, we also have to calculate the third value. Then we'll be getting to the fourth value like that. Okay, we are here. So let's calculate it manually without thinking of the code, how we are going to do that. So if we have to calculate G3, what will it be? This time 2 is there. A is 2, 2 into 1, plus B is also 2, 2 into 1, plus C is 2, all right? And the modulo is going to be with 100. So the number will be exactly the same. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have 6 here. So we can put 6 here. Now we have to calculate G4, the main answer. For this, n minus 1 is 6, right? So the series will be 2 into 6 plus 2 into 1, where n minus 2 is going to be this number. 2 into 1 plus C, 2, right? This is going to be your 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. We have to do it modulo with 100. It is going to be 16, right? So this is how these are being calculated. So solving these, you will have the approaches to solve the Fibonacci, right? This is just a basic Fibonacci with some modification. So for just as you solve a Fibonacci using recursion, you can do that. But that would be, that would be giving a complexity up to 2 to the power n. And we do not need that. When we optimize it using DP, we can store the values in a linear fashion. Then again, eventually we'd be ending up optimizing this solution only up to ON, not further to that. Also, if we have to optimize it in terms of a space, we can do that. We would not be storing the values inside a 1D array. Rather, what we would use some variables so that we can have the track of just two previous values, right? Not the further previous ones. So for that too, the space complexity might reduce, the time complexity would still be ON, right? So we don't have to use these approaches here. The question demands a solution in log n. So for log n, what we do for solving Fibonacci is using the concept of matrix exponentiation. All right, so we are going to be discussing this concept and we'll be seeing how we can solve Fibonacci using matrix exponentiation. Matrix exponentiation in itself is composed of two concepts again, which is your matrix multiplication and your binary exponentiation. Okay, we are going to discuss both in brief. So here, as you can see, matrix multiplication. Okay, you have to recall, these were the conditions that you might already know. For matrix multiplication, when you have two matrices, A and B, and the dimension of those are M into K and K into P, the resultant matrix would be A into B. The dimension of that are going to be A cross P, right? Okay, the condition is that the number of columns in the first one should always be equal to number of rows of the second matrix, right? As you can see, these K, obviously, this is M dot K and K dot P, where K is the same thing. The answer that you will get is number of rows of the first one cross number of columns of the second one. The answer matrix is going to be of this dimension, right? This is a very important concept and you should keep this in mind. Now, talking about binary exponentiation. So what do you mean by binary exponentiation? Let's see it with an example. Assume if you have to find a to the power 10, okay? What you can do? You can either multiply a 10 times, right? So seeing this question, like seeing this approach, a general thing that comes through your mind is the solution would somewhere be near to on, right? You have to calculate, you have to do a into a 10 times. But is this the best approach? Obviously not, right? So what could be a better approach? If we have to find a to the power 10, what we can do is, we can find a to the power 5 and we can multiply it 2 times, correct? That would give us the same answer. Similarly, if we have to find a to the power 5, what we can do? Considering a is not an even number, it is an odd number, we can do this. We can say, please calculate a square and a. When these are calculated, we'll multiply these to get a5. Talking about a2, again, a2 can be, we can achieve that by multiplying a2 times, right? So we are going like this. And this is how our steps are being reduced. And these are being reduced to log n complexity. Okay? Now, how we are going to implement this this concept in terms of Fibonacci? How we can achieve the answer? Let's see the intuition. Well, the intuition says to get such a matrix with Fibonacci relation that when is exponentiated, it gives the values of the Fibonacci sequence. Okay, so we have to figure out a matrix which is in the relation of Fibonacci, right? The terms inside it are related in a Fibonacci manner. So that when we exponentiate it, when we increase its power, what will happen? We will be getting the further matrices, and the further matrices will be storing our Fibonacci values, which could be our nth value that we have to find, right? Let's see the formulation of this matrix that we have to figure out. So these are the equations that we have already given. So as we can see, if we have to calculate fn, the formula was a times fn minus 1 plus b times fn minus 2 plus c, right? If we put n minus 1 in place of n, what changes will it make? This will be a times fn minus 2 plus b times fn minus 3 and plus c, correct? Now, if you have to assume, okay, if we have to put this in a matrix, we can do something like this, correct? Let's talk about the RHS first to avoid confusion. If we have to form it in a matrix, we have three terms here. So that means the first row should be consisting of three values. That is how when we multiply some other matrix to it, we will be achieving this equation, right? So for that, we have taken one matrix. The answer will be coming into a 3x3 matrix. But how we have reached there, I'm going to show you that. Okay. So if we assume that, and if we put that in a matrix, and the first matrix here is Fn minus 1 and C, and when we multiply it with this, Fn minus 1, Fn minus 2, C, the last term. So what will happen? The basic concept here is, if we have previous value present with us, we multiply such a matrix, okay, such a matrix that we still have to figure out, to it, and when multiplied, the answer will be the nth step, okay? We have n minus 1th step. We will multiply some matrix with it, which will lead us to our answer. Okay, this is the concept. We have to figure out what is this matrix. And because we have already built this matrix and this matrix, this is basically what we have to find and what is present with us. So is this, right? This is 3 cross 1. This is also 3 cross 1. If we see, we have already just seen that these are the value of m and k. For if we don't even know initially what the dimensions of mat are, how will we figure out? It is 3 into 1, it is 3 into 1. This is m, this is p, this is k, this is p. So what we have to do? We have to figure out these values in such a way, which are m and k. M is already given as 3 and k should be 3 here. Only then the condition that we have for matrix multiplication will be satisfied and we can move further on. I hope it is clear till now. Now, let's see this. Okay. When we are clear with the dimensions, I have given some variables to it. Of what we have to do it, because we have to find out this complete matrix, we have to find out each and every value of this matrix. Let's talk about the row one. Okay, when we multiply this with this, what we will have is something like this. M00, Fn minus 1, plus M10, Fn minus 2, plus M02, C. Correct? It is also U01. Okay. Yeah. So when you have gotten this, we will compare it with the equation that we are given, this one. Okay. So what can we conclude with that equation? That this value, M00, will be corresponding to A. M01 will be corresponding to B, and M02 will be corresponding to 1. Correct? Only then we can achieve it. Because we have to make it like this, right? We know that in this place, B F minus 2 is written. That means the value of M01 is going to be B. Here, only C is written. So we have to conclude that M02 will be 1. Only then we can get C here. So this is how we have formed this equation and we have gotten the value of these three elements. All right. Talking about the next row. Okay. So what we have to do? We know that when we are finding Fn minus 1, we have done the same multiplication with this row and this row again. So we have M10, Fn minus 1, M11, Fn minus 2 plus M12, C. Correct? What we will do? Now that we know, if we have to make this equation, like we have to satisfy the equality, what we can do? We have to cancel this element. We have to cancel this element. Only then we will receive Fn minus 1 and Fn minus 1, which will be equal, right? So for doing that, we have to make the value of this M11 to be 0. Correct? Value of this M12 to be 0. So that these two elements are cancelled. These two elements are cancelled then. The only value left will be this, M10, Fn minus 1. And for making it equal to Fn minus 1, what we will do is, we will keep M10 as 1, right? So we have gotten the values of next row as well, 100. This is the second row. For this, the answer was A, B, and 1, the first row. Let's talk about the last row now. Okay, the last row is C equals M20. Fn minus 1 plus M21, Fn minus 2 plus M22, C. Correct? Again, we have to do the same thing. We have to satisfy the equality. How we are going to do that? We will be cancelling this term and this term this time. Alright? So for doing so, we are going to be keeping the value of this as 0, of this as 0. And for M22, we will be keeping this value as 1. Only then we will be doing C equals C. That means that we also have figured out our last row, which is this 001, correct? Okay, so we have successfully formed our matrix that is needed. So this is the matrix that when we exponentiate it, when we multiply it with the previous value, what we will receive is our nth answer. Okay. Now again, let's solve the equation. Now we know that, assuming this is the matrix that we have found, let's shorten it and represent it as xn. If this is xn, this exactly will be xn minus 1, right? Only one level, only one step previous. The matrix is going to be same. Okay, so we have to figure out a relation in order to know that how much we have to exponentiate this matrix so that we will be going, like we will be achieving our answer. Okay. Okay, we already know that when x, this is the given equation that we have already formed here. If we do xn minus 1, what changes will it make? It will say mad, and this n minus 1 will turn into n minus 2, correct? If we put this value here, then what will happen? It will be something like this. Xn equals mad multiplied with mad, which will be mad square, and xn minus 2, correct? If we do the same thing again, if we find out the value of xn minus 2 and put that here, it will be cube xn minus 3. So this series will go on and on. In general form, we can write it like this. When we are multiplying it like k times, what is happening? We are exponentiating mat till k into xn minus k. Okay? In a general way. Now we have to see one thing. We have to notice that how many values are there in the series that are already given to us. There are two values, correct? The g1 and g2. That means we do not need to find that. That is our base case. We cannot go below that. So this is the case for us. N minus k, whatsoever is n minus k, should be always greater than or equal to 2. So solving the equality, we can get k equals to n minus 2, right? So keeping that value here, we will receive this. Okay? Mat n minus 2 multiplied with x2 will give us xn. Right? So again, we are here. We will receive this, which is our answer basically, when we find out this result matrix. What is this result matrix? The matrix mat exponentiated to n minus 2, right? This is our result matrix. When we get that result matrix, then what we will do is, we will multiply that with x2. What is x2? F n minus 1, F n minus 2, and C. If n is 2, then what will happen? F1, F0, and C. Okay, these are the three values that we have to find. Correct? And these are the actual values that we are given. Right? So the main focus of R is now to find out this rest. Let's see how we can do that. Here is the algorithm for the same. So what we will do is, we will create a matrix, the one that we have found the value of, and then we'll input n. Actually, you are already getting the n in your parameters. Then we have to solve it recursively. We have just seen the concept of binary exponentiation. We are going to be using that now, but in forms of matrix, which will make it matrix exponentiation. All right? So the basic motive is, if we have to find m n minus 2, or just say if we have to find mn, what we will do is, we will find out mat n by 2, this value. And once we have found that, we will multiply it twice. And we are going to be doing it in a recursive manner. So assuming if we have to, a is the matrix, and if we have to find a to the power 8, what we'll do is, we'll find out a to the power 4, we'll multiply it 2 times. We'll find out a square if we have to find out a to the power 4. And if we have to find a square, we'll multiply a 2 times. Okay. This is going to be happening in a recursive manner, which will lead our complexity to be log n then. Okay. Now let's see this recursive function. Okay. The very first thing is the base case. If n equals to 1, we are going to return the mat itself, because you cannot exponentiate it like to the power 1. It is the matrix itself. So you are going to be returning the mat. When not, we will create a temporary variable, and we will get the value of mat to the power n by 2. Correct? We have done the same thing here. Now we have to check if the n is even, if the n that we are receiving is even. That means if you are getting a to the power 4 and 4, the value is even. So what we can do, we can multiply 10 two times. So we can do a square into a square, correct? But what if n is odd? What if you have a to the power 5? What you will do is you will multiply 10 two times and you will multiply mat one time more. So what you'll do, you will do a to the power 2 multiplied with a to the power 2 into a. Okay, this is going to be your answer. Once this recursive function is done and it has returned a resultant matrix to us, now what is that we have to do? Once we have received the matrix, we have to use this formula that is given to us. Okay, we have already figured out why we are doing this. Let's see it again. Because of this, we have gotten this matrix. We have now gotten the result matrix. Okay, so result and the result matrix, whatsoever is going to be the answer, we will multiply those with these, correct? Like this. We're going to be doing this. Once that is achieved, we will return that as our answer. Okay. Now, there's one point that you need to take care of. You should be handling this corner case in the beginning itself. So if you are being asked for N1 and N2, which are the values you are already given, right, in the question. So you should simply return 1 modulo and whatsoever the value of M is, correct? This. So let's see the code for it. Okay. So here's the code for same. Let's read it. Here are your parameters, the function that you were given. We have created it. We have created this matrix. Now we have seen the base case here. If N is 1 and N is 2 or N is 2, what we will do is we will return 1 modulo M. As simple as that. We do not need to solve when these values are given. Now what we'll do is we will call a function to give us a resultant matrix. And this function, what we are giving, the mat itself that we have created right now, and n minus 2. We have figured out why we are sending n minus 2, because we need to exponentiate mat n minus 2 times, right? And then we are sending this m, with which we have to find the modulo, right? Once this function is called, we will be here. And here's the base case for the recursive function. When n reaches 1, we have to return the mat. If not, we have to create a temporary variable, which is a temporary matrix for now. What we will do is, we will solve it only one time. We won't call this function twice. We will just give the parameters mat, n divided by 2 to get the half value, and then m, right? Once that is done, okay, what we will do is, we will check if it is even, then we will do this. If it is not even, then we will do this. What we are doing, we are multiplying temp and temp, and we are also sending m. What we are doing, we are multiplying with temp. We are multiplying temp two times, and then we are sending m as well. Why m? Because we have to find modulo with it. Okay. Now, this is the basic code written for multiplying two matrices, receiving these three parameters. I have created one dummy matrix for now, which I have named as answer. I filled 0 in it. This is a 3x3 matrix. And then I've used this nested loop, the very classic nested loop for your multiplying matrices, right? And when this returns your answer, the answer is going to be received here and it will be returned to the final solution, correct? And if the value is odd, what it will do is it will multiply temp and temp, and then whatsoever the answer is, it will multiply that one more time with mat, correct? So now let's see how this code is working. Okay, so here's the code. Let's compile it. Okay, so it is giving us the right output. Let's see, let's submit that and see if it is working for all the test cases. All right, so it is working for every test case. So the code is working properly. I hope this video was helpful for you. If you have any problem, if you are facing any difficulty in the code, then you should see this video again, and I hope you'll be understanding it well. Okay, thank you.